Today we are going to talk about the optimal amount of rest for muscle gain. In a video last week titled Big Weights or Big Volume for Big Muscle, there was a lot of confusion. And that's the purpose for this video. What I said in that video was you have two options for building muscle optimally. You can use really big weights, meaning 2 to 3 times your body weight, or you can use big volume. Another way of saying big volume is time under tension. The reason I didn't use that is it's become kind of a catchphrase that's become meaningless, but we'll explore that in detail in the next hour. So what is the optimal set rest time for muscle gain? About this time, people are gonna say, well, I heard that, or I thought that rest, okay, let's cover that. Let the clutch out slowly and engage the brain so you don't sprain it. Think about all those things you've heard about rest. There's 3 kinds of rest. What kind of rest were they talking about? Do they mean rest like sleep at night? Do they mean rest like you have to catch your breath? Or do they mean rest like your muscles really, really sore and you need to wait a while before the muscle recovers? It's really important that you think about what kind of rest it is that you actually need. Now, one thing you're gonna notice in this workout I'm doing, you're not gonna see me stop. I'm going to be lifting or walking between exercises the whole time. Now, about this time, someone's gonna say, everyone's different. No, everyone is not different. Sorry. Everyone has a different set of limitations and injuries to work around. That's true. It's true that 90-year-olds need more recovery than 18-year-olds. But no, everyone is not different. The optimal workout to gain muscle does not vary whether you're a hard gainer or an easy gainer. If you like texting between sets, that's fine, but it's not optimal. Now, people have fought me all along saying their 5 minutes between sets of texting is multitasking or that they need it. Seriously, you don't need to make excuses or convince me. Own it. It's okay. Remember, my rule number one is the workout you do consistently because you love it is far superior to the best workout that you never do. So if it takes texting 5 minutes between sets to keep you interested in your weight workout, that's fine because you're doing a workout. It may not be quote unquote optimal, but you're doing it. Okay, so in my opinion, it's time under, well, there's 2 ways to build muscle, as I said before. It's the powerlifting approach or the bodybuilding approach. If you're doing a bodybuilding approach, it's time under tension that builds muscle, and that's what you want to maximize to gain muscle. It's a workout like the one you're watching me do right now that maximizes muscle gain. You'll note that except the exercises, there is no rest. Probably if you actually got out of the stopwatch, you'd see the time under tension is probably, you know, 35, 40 minutes. Most people are lucky to get 6 minutes of time under tension in their workout. You know, if you have time to waist, then yeah, you could do 10 hours of workouts a week, each of which only has 6 minutes of time under tension, and you'd get as good a workout as I do in my 2 1-hour workouts. If you have time to do that, that's fine. Now, let's go back to the different kinds of rest I talked about. Yes, sleep is important. That's a kind of rest. The muscles that you tear down in your workout are actually built at night when you're resting. If you're not sleeping enough, you're not rebuilding the muscles. Now, the second kind of rest people talk about is you have to catch your breath. That's a cardiovascular kind of rest. And there's no question, if you're squatting twice your body weight for reps, you are gonna be huffing and puffing and it's gonna take you 5 minutes to catch your breath. But that's not gonna happen on bicep curls. You don't have to rest your cardiovascular system doing an isolation workout like I'm doing now. If you do, you have the cardiovascular health of a 90-year-old smoker, and you need to stop your smoking and start your cardio so that you can do this kind of shit. Again, the last kind of rest, though, is the fact that the muscle needs rest between sets. By muscle, I mean the specific one you're doing. So right now, I'm about to start doing curls. And the last time I did curls was, 5 minutes ago. My bicep has had time to rest because I've worked out other muscles in the meantime. Now, let's cover this. A lot of people get really confused with this time under tension stuff. It's like, if it's just time under tension, then you could grab a 1 pound dumbbell and do bicep curls for an hour using a 1 pound dumbbell. Is that gonna get you 21 inch arms? Not a chance. It's a trade-off. What I'm doing here, I'm using weights that I would use in a traditional 3 sets of 8 kind of workout with 2 minutes between sets. That is the amount of weight I'm using. I'm not using like 1 pound dumbbells. Okay, now here comes the asterisk part. I've made it look black and white. You're either doing a powerlifting kind of workout or you're doing a bodybuilding kind of workout. That is clearly not true. Advanced bodybuilders combine powerlifting and bodybuilding. You don't get to be a Jay Cutler kind of physique doing isolation exercises like I'm doing here alone. They do a combination of a powerlifting style workout and a bodybuilding style workout. So, what is the optimal time of rest between sets for a bodybuilder? 0, 0, 0, 0. And that is because it's time under tension and you do not gain muscle while you're sitting there texting. It's as simple as that. Okay, now let me answer your questions. I will only be answering questions on this subject. Okay. How many exercises per muscle group do you usually do per round of each circuit? That's a good question. What I do is different than what you will do. Not because everyone's different, but because I'm 60 years old and have no cartilage in my shoulder, a lower back that barely lets me get out of bed in the morning, and a bad knee. So I do whatever I can. Which a lot of times there's just one exercise I can do for a muscle, but that's fine. Do what you can. Now, if you're 18 with great joints, I think what I would do is a workout like this, but I think I would organize it such that I did opposing muscles. That's what I used to do. So, for example, I would do, I might do a supersetting workout like this where I do chest and lats. That would be a big one. So every time I alternate between a chest exercise and a lat exercise. And then the next day I might do a leg workout where I do a quad exercise, then a hamstring exercise and alternate between those. So yeah, that was a good question and it depends. Okay, how many reps do you recommend for someone who's already lifted weights but never did deadlift before? So let me answer the first part of your question. How many reps do I do? I do every set to failure. That's part of the time under tension. People would argue with that, but you know, that's what I say, go to failure. Now, as far as for deadlifts, it's really important you nail the form flawlessly before you lift what you're actually capable of the deadlift. What I would do is start by just lifting the bar, video yourself from the side and the front, and post it to a forum where you trust. I would suggest a paid forum, not a free forum where there's gonna be a bunch of trolls. And have people check your form and give you pointers on that before you even slap 10 pounds on the side. And slowly move up and do that, because you can hurt yourself bad if you do deadlifts before you have the form nailed. Okay. Do you need full range of motion on exercise? No, you do not. A lot of bodybuilders have been brainwashed into thinking that if they don't use full range of motion, that they're leaving gains on the table. What they're leaving is joint injuries on the table. You know, there's kind of a gradation. On the one end of the spectrum, you have isometrics, where the joints don't move at all. And then you have the full range of motion, the people that do ass to grass squats, and the people when they're doing shoulder exercises that look like they're a bird flapping their wings. In between there somewhere is the sweet spot where you can gain muscle while doing minimal damage to your shoulder. And I personally have feelings for what that point is after 60 years of experience and destroying my shoulder, and I'll get into that sometime. Strength training is better than bodybuilding. Tell me that when you're 60. Is what I would say. I think most bodybuilders and powerlifters would disagree with you. There's times it's beneficial to switch back and forth between the two, and a lot of powerlifters do that. Okay, let's see, let's get to some more questions. When doing calisthenics circuits, is going to failure a must for gaining muscle? Now, just a pet peeve of mine, don't use big words like hypertrophy. A lot of people use them without realizing what they really mean. I'm not saying you don't, but ask the real question that you want to know, which is gaining muscle. So first of all, in my opinion, calisthenics is not optimal for gaining muscle. Having said that, goes back to my rule number one, which is, you people probably know at this point, but rule number one is, the workout you do consistently because you love it is far superior to the best workout you never do. So if you love calisthenics, yeah, that is optimal for you. The thing is, there's very few 60-year-olds doing calisthenics. I know you can point to one or two, but most of them quit because their shoulders are destroyed. You also do not see any 60-year-old gymnasts. Do you need to all sets to failure or the last set for gaining muscle? Asks Eagle-Eyed John. Personally, I do every single set to failure. I'm a believer that the gains come from the last rep or two. And the argument against going to failure that a lot of people use is that it keeps you from being able to do the volume or the time under tension required to gain muscle. As you see here, I'm going to failure, and I am not having any trouble continuing to do this nonstop. So that's their typical argument. There's a bodybuilder hiding in my closet. Okay, how do you lift weight safely when lifting at home? Exactly like I am here. Don't do anything stupid. I would say avoid having an Olympic bar over your head. Do not be doing squats or bench press unless you have a safety rack like this and you're in it using safety catch bars. It doesn't do any good if you just use it as a hat rack. Okay, I'll cover this a little bit. I mentioned before that I've done a lot of wear and tear on my joints and that my shoulder has all the cartilage gone. Why is this? Because I've been lifting heavy and consistently since I was like 19. And if you think about it, the joints and the body are just a mechanical device. Like any hinge in your car, if you open it a lot, it's gonna wear out. If you open the door with a 200-pound weight hanging from it, it's gonna wear out a lot faster. Mechanical things just wear out. And that's why bodybuilders who lift a lot of weight have their joints wear out. What's the best substitute for squats? Well, by the way, you'll notice I was doing weighted pull-ups, and now I just switched to bodyweight pull-ups. The reason is I want to go to failure, but with the dumbbell, failure would have been like four reps. And that doesn't help my time under tension, which is why I lowered the weight there to get a reasonable amount of time under tension. Look at Ronnie Coleman, he's wrecked. I wouldn't know about that. Gregorio says, you're still pretty strong, especially in the chest flies. I actually don't, I don't do any dumbbell work for chest, because my shoulder doesn't allow. What I do now is just push-ups. These reverse flies I was just doing are for upper back and traps. Yes, I do need to do a whole video series on joint health and how to optimize muscle gain while minimizing wear and tear on the shoulders. The unfortunate thing, excuse me, is that there is no perfect answer. You can optimize for shoulder health and longevity, or you can optimize for muscle gain and strength. There's a third option which will surprise you, but that's a subject of another video. Okay, would you have trained slightly different in the past 40, knowing what I do know about the joints? You know, I think if I could go back and be 19 again, I would do a lot of things differently when it comes to bodybuilding. But remember, when I started lifting, there was no internet. The only information available on bodybuilding were the muscle rags that would lie to people and pretend that people like Arnold were natural. And then there were the books in the library that were so generic as to be completely void of benefit. So I had to make a lot of my own mistakes because there was no information out there. Hold on, please. Sorry, I need a second. I'll be right, let's see. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't finish answering this. About the best exercise for quads. The best exercise for quads is squats, if you can do them. If you can't do them, then certainly there's anything is better than nothing. My first choice would be a plate-loaded leg press machine, because those come close to simulating what the squat does, and it allows you to lift a lot of weight safely without a spotter. Then you could do, if you're able, you could do things like at a home workout. Say you are not able to do squats or leg press. Then you could do things like lunges or hex bar squats. You could do those safely, but my knees and lower back do not allow that. Okay, let's get to some more questions here. So let's see, if you notice, so I've been working out like 23 minutes now. I was doing weighted pull-ups, and then as I started to get tired, I switched to just body weight pull-ups. And now I'm going to do a low row on the suspension trainer. So that's what I'm switching to here. Oh, let's see. Does the tempo cause more soreness in the muscle? Well, first of all, you'll notice when I do workouts, I do very slow, deliberate form, really slow reps. The reason is that is a way to work the muscles while putting the least stress on the joints and minimizing the chance of muscle pulls and tendon problems. You know, you see people doing like ballistic pull-ups, like where you clapping pull-ups. Those are a great trick, but those put incredible loads on your muscles, tendons, and those are just asking for injury, in my opinion. So if the high tempo means you're doing a ballistic kind of workout, those have their place. And you know, if you're a boxer, you have to do ballistic stuff or mixed martial arts, because people aren't going to wait around for your incredibly slow, powerful punch to hit their face. You got to be quick. So I hope I answered that one. Rick says, do you believe high rep workouts are just as effective as low rep workouts? That's what this whole video was about. Please go back and watch the first 26 minutes of this video. James says, having watched your video for years, I see people at my gym all the time putting their shoulders at risk. It's true. People just don't get this, and I've been saying this for 20 years now. You gotta keep your elbows out in front of you where you can see them, or you're risking trashing your shoulders. Things like behind the neck pull-ups, behind the neck military press, dumbbell flies where you let the get on the bench and let the dumbbells almost hit the floor. Those are just asking to trash your shoulder. But people are on this kick where they think high range of motion is what's required to gain muscle. It's like, knock yourself out. Let me know how that works for you. Leonard says, do you believe in junk volume? I think that probably is what I was talking about when I said, you know, you can grab 1 pound dumbbells and do dumbbell press for an hour and it's not gonna do anything for you. You still have to lift respectable weights. And by that I mean what you would be doing if you were doing a traditional 3 sets of 8 kind of workout with 2 to 3 minutes rest between sets. That's the weight you need to be doing. Okay, you picked the wrong house, fool, says, thoughts on evolving rep ranges for progression, adding extra set when lowering the reps to keep a steady progression. Well, powerlifting and progressions. And in that case, what you really need to do is to choose a good standard powerlifting program, of which there are many, or strength training, you know, 5x5, starting strength if you're getting started, whatever it is. The Johnny, I'm sorry, I'm gonna murder his last name, Candido, something like that. He has amazing workouts, do his. They all have programming. It's like, stick to the program. Whatever they say for rep ranges and amount to increase each week, do that. As far as bodybuilding goes, what I'm showing here is what I personally believe to be optimal. I am not resting because I am trying to get as much time under tension in an hour as I can. And you will notice I do lower the weight. As I mentioned before, when I was doing pull-ups, I started with weighted pull-ups, and then I dropped to body weight pull-ups, and then now I'm doing these suspension trainer rows with 25 pounds, which is even easier than the body weight pull-ups. So, yeah. Okay, Anthony says, if you compared your strength to other men your age, how many times stronger are you? Well, first of all, I rarely compare myself to other men my age. And honestly, that's pretty pathetic. Most men my age can't do a push-up or a pull-up, and nor can they run a 5K. Most people my age are sitting on the sofa drinking beer to enhance their beer belly. If I was gonna compare myself to anyone, I'd compare myself to like 30-year-olds. Give me some competition. Or, by the way, you'll notice Sammy, our turtle in the background. He's a rescue turtle, and you can see he loves his cardio. He's been swimming the whole time in this video. Okay. I screwed up the camera. You'll notice, although this is not really live, I'm playing a 1 hour video that I filmed. It was filmed nonstop. There's no editing here. And I screwed up. I tried to zoom in and it didn't work. So now I'm back, wide angle. Isn't running hard on the joints? That's a good question. Yes, if you do it wrong. Most people do it wrong. They jackhammer the pavement, counting on their cushy running shoe heels to absorb their horrible running style. It's all about landing technique. And if you're landing on your heels, it's called heel strike, it just jackhammers all your joints and it's bad. Basically, the idea is you want to try to minimize the bouncing up and down of your body, and you want to land on forefoot. Typically, what that means is you have to do a much higher RPM running style than seems natural, because that forces you to take shorter strides, which lets you land on the midfoot rather than the heel. And then when you land on the midfoot, then your ankles and your calves can absorb all that pressure that would normally be telescoped to your ankles, knees, and other joints. Okay. Are you still suffering from back pain? It's been a part of my life since I was 20. And you know what? I don't even go to the doctor for it because I know exactly what would happen. They would take MRIs and say, oh, this is, you have a herniated disc and you have this and you have that. And you know, we need to operate now. And the truth is the success rate on spine operations is pathetic. And there's no point in going to a doctor for something when there's no solution. And as far as I'm concerned, there's no solution. I will wait until I'm in a wheelchair with back pain before I go to the doctor to have something done. Okay, excuse me. Let's see. Interesting question from John. I tend to include too many exercises per muscle group. Is two exercises per muscle group sufficient for muscle gain and development? Okay, let's review Scooby's rule number one, which is the workout you do consistently because you love it is far superior to the best workout you never do. If doing a zillion different sets keeps you interested and excited in your workout, then that is what you should do. A lot of people would be bored with the kind of workout I'm doing here, which is I'm basically just doing one exercise per muscle group. And that would drive a lot of people crazy. So just remember rule number one. Okay, really interesting question. Is it easier to maintain muscle than build it? Or is there an equal effort to both build and maintain? That is an excellent question. And let me tell you why. So in my 40s and 50s, I worked out harder than ever and didn't gain any muscle. There's an interesting curve where when you're a newbie, your effort is basically proportional to your gains. But as you gain muscle and get closer to your natural limit, it doesn't matter how much you lift, you're not gonna gain more muscle or get stronger. There's natural limits. And the thing is, if you back off, you don't lose that muscle. So the question is, how much can you back off and still keep your muscle? You know, if I could go back in time to age 40, I would have done a lot more experimentation with that, knowing what I know about shoulder wear and tear. I think when I reached my maximum genetic potential in like 2001, when I was 40, I think at that point, I would have switched to a really shoulder, I don't know what I just said. I would switch to a very shoulder-friendly workout. I would have skipped the dumbbells and done a lot of push-ups and low-stress shoulder exercises for chest. So, yes, it's far easier to maintain than it is to gain muscle. Okay, for powerlifting to gain muscle, should rest time be dictated by your own standards or by how much you can do the big three compared to your body weight? Again, I would stick precisely to the strength training plan that you're doing, whether it be 5x5, starting strength, or one of Johnny's plans. Stick to that. That is optimal. Now, if you've been lifting 10, 15 years and you're an IFBB pro bodybuilder, you know enough that you can come up with your own plan. You can come up with your own hybrid bodybuilding powerlifting plan. And I can't do that because I'm not there, nor will I ever be. Jeff Carter, can I maintain my gains using only calisthenics? Gyms are closed here. Define calisthenics. That's different than body weight exercises. Okay, how many sets per week per muscle group? Again, I can't really answer that. What I try to do that I think is optimal, so working out each muscle just once a week is not optimal for a bodybuilder. I would say twice a week for each particular muscle is optimal for a bodybuilder. That's different for a power lifter. Again, stick to the training. If you're doing squats with 3x your body weight, you're probably only gonna do that once a week. But this kind of workout that I'm doing here is best done where you hit each muscle twice in a week. In my case, I will do this particular workout twice. So I now have only 2 hours of bodybuilding per week. But you'll notice, you calculate my time under tension, and I'm probably getting 5x the lifting that most people get going to the gym every day, just because they spend all their time resting between sets and texting. Okay. What do you think about burpees? Can they build muscle and get in shape with burpees? Burpees are great if you can do them. They're great for cardiovascular exercise, and they're also a good full body workout. No question. I personally can't do them anymore, but that's okay. Okay, the question is how often, I'm going to answer the general question they're asking about bicycling. How often do you do cardio? Well, it's interesting. So this time of year, the days are so short that I can't do what I like doing. What I like doing is getting cardio every single day, but I also like flying and working on Dottie, and both those require daylight. So what I do on these short days of winter, I alternate days of lifting or doing cardio. So I'll be doing cardio 5 days. I can either do cardio or Dottie. I misspoke. So any particular day I have to choose whether I'm gonna fly Dottie or do cardio. So I alternate days. So I'm getting like 3 to 4 days of cardio a week. But what I do, that cardio is about 3 hours. What I do is I bike an hour and a half and I bike to my trailhead where I do a hour and a half hike. So since I'm not able to do it every day, I do a double duty. Does CrossFit make you lose muscle? Well, anything that injures you and has you sitting on the sofa eating bonbons makes you lose muscle. And since CrossFit is one of the most injury-prone workout styles on the planet. Yes. I crack myself up. Yes, because CrossFit is the most likely to make you injured, it's also the most likely to make you lose muscle. Let's
play around. This is the new leg extension machine.
So this is a new leg extension machine we just got. It's gonna need some modifications because it's made for someone 5 feet tall. The problem is the shin pad is like 6 inches too close to my knees. And it's fine for someone that's lifting baby weights, but when I'm trying to lift this much weight, it feels like razor blades shoving into my shins. So that's why I have that pad there. I'm amusing myself here. Let's see. My do-it-yourself leg extension machine died after years of good use. That's what happened to it. And the good thing about this, it's a leg curl machine also. As you can see, I kicked the tripod over here and it's filming my kneecap now. That's me working out, that's not Scott.
That was kind of funny. Okay.
How to maintain gains when gyms are closed? I don't have weights. Well, I would have referred you to my website, but I shut it down. You need to find a way to do workout. Get a suspension trainer. Find a place to do pull-ups, do push-ups. Do what you can. Okay, so notice I've been working out 45 minutes here without rest. And I'm still, actually, I've been doing these weighted suspension trainer rows for a long time, and it still feels really good. I actually love this exercise. Yeah, if you need weights, find heavy shit around the house. Filled bottles or 5 gallon buckets are awesome. A 5 gallon bucket is a dumbbell waiting to happen. You might need to put something on the handle grip so that it doesn't dig into your hands, a piece of a towel or something. But that's an adjustable dumbbell that's, you know, right there in your house. Eagle Eye John, do you train naked when not on YouTube? I train in my Speedo. In the summer, it can be 120 in this garage. So yeah, I train in my Speedo. Oh yeah, and for the person that asked what to do to maintain muscle when they can't get in gyms, resistance bands. So to summarize, resistance bands, pull-up bar, suspension trainer, push-ups, and then using heavy objects like a 5 gallon bucket full of water. There's no reason you cannot come up with a creative workout that will even let you gain muscle using those things. Okay, here's an interesting question. Do you do anything for calves? Yes. What I do is when I run, I land on midfoot. Landing midfoot is one of the best calf workouts you can do. And it's even better if you run on sand because it forces you to run on the balls of your feet. Scooby, what was the name of the music that used London, London, yes, London? That's on my playlist. If you'd have to go to the waybackmachine.org and find any page that has Spotify listed. It's on that playlist. Yeah, I can't remember the name of that song, but that's one of my favorites. You're making me smile. If you'll notice, I often lift with a song on repeat one. The same song has been playing this entire 50 minutes. For me, it's all about focus. And a lot of times I'll just hear a song and I don't want to sound like hocus pocus here, but it puts me in the right zone for lifting. And I don't want to be hearing other songs. It's like, this is my song. This is going to help me focus. So I just listen to that song on repeat one. And it's different for different workouts. I mean, I see this all the time at the gym. You see someone standing there and they're like scrolling through all their songs looking for they spend their whole workout looking for the right song. It's like, dude, either make a playlist or turn it off. You're wasting all your gym time. Are military presses necessary for shoulder development? Well, nothing is necessary. There's always ways to work around. For example, you know, I'm doing leg extension here. Are squats necessary for quad development? No, they're good for it. Most people do it because it's one of the best exercises for it, but not everyone can do it. Same with military presses. And I can't do military presses because of my shoulder, which is why you see me doing side raises and reverse flies. Okay. Really interesting question from Neutral. Should I skip my leg day if I have naturally thick legs? No way in hell. I say work out every single muscle as hard as you can. If you have certain body parts that respond really well, go for it. Nobody is gonna yell at you and make fun of you because you have monster quads. They're gonna quiver in their boots. So lift every muscle to its max and just be happy whatever muscle you have that responds in a superior fashion. For me, that was pecs. For you, that's legs. That's awesome. Okay, let's see. There's a lot of people asking questions. Let me summarize this video. So, in a previous video titled Big Weights or Big Volume for Big Muscle, what I said was, there's two ways you can gain muscle. You can do it using a powerlifting style workout where you're lifting 2 to 3 times your body weight on the exercises you're doing. And on those, you can rest all you want. Follow whatever the strength training program says. On the other hand, if you're doing a bodybuilding style workout using isolation exercises and weights less than your body weight, then volume is what builds muscle. Another way of saying volume is time under tension. So the optimal rest between sets for muscle gain, if you were a bodybuilder, is zero. Zero rest is optimal. This kind of workout is optimal because I am getting 40 minutes of time under tension in an hour workout. That is optimal. Now, if you're in your 20s or 30s, you would not be doing a full body workout like this. What you would do, you would probably have 2 or 3 different supersetting workouts like this. You would have a leg supersetting workout where your entire workout was just quads, hamstrings alternating between them. And then you would have maybe a workout where you alternate between chest exercises and lat exercises. And then maybe your third supersetting workout would be shoulders supersetted with arm exercises. So you do a shoulder, a tricep exercise, then a bicep exercise and repeat. So when you're talking, when you hear people say, I heard that you have to rest between sets. It's like, what do you mean by rest? Do you mean sleeping at night?
I want to see how long it's
hold been. On a second here. I'm gonna turn off the volume. By rest, do you mean you're out of breath and you have to stop and catch your breath? Or do you mean that the particular muscle needs recovery? You got to think about what it is that you're talking about there. And in this supersetting style workout, I'll do a lat exercise and then it's 5-7 minutes before I do another lat exercise. So I'm getting plenty of muscular rest for my lats. Aaron says, so ecto, endo, meso counts, or does it matter? No, everyone is the same. There is no special workout style for hard gainers. Everyone has to do the same thing to gain muscle optimally. If the hard gainer workout let hard gainers gain muscle faster, then everyone would do it. It's that simple. How do you know when your workout is done? Good question. So first of all, if you're a beginner, stick to a standard free workout that you find on the internet and do not improve it. Any improvements you make will actually make it worse. So if that standard workout program says rest 1 minute between sets, do it. Having said that, so if you've been working out like 10, 20 years, you kind of, I call it, it's like when I'm cooked. It's like, I can tell when I've come to the point where it's not gonna do any more good and it's gonna be overtraining. For me, that I can kind of feel that point coming on. So after about 10 minutes of doing a workout like this, I can feel my lats getting really pumped. And as the workout goes on, it gets to the point where that pump is gone and it's a little hard to describe. It's like my muscles feel like they won't work. It's like, that's the time to stop for me. And it's different for different workouts. In a workout like I'm doing here, where I'm actually getting a lot of rest between each muscle that's working out, I can sometimes go 90 minutes and still feel really good. Whereas if I was doing that workout I described before where I was just doing alternating chest and lat exercises, I would be cooked at like 45 minutes. So it really depends. Good question there. I'm almost done with this workout, which ends at 60 minutes, so I'm gonna wrap it up by saying, let me get a few more questions in here. Thoughts on calf, forearm, ab, and neck training. Okay, good question. How many hours a week do you have available for fitness? There's only 24 hours in a day. There's all kinds of things you can do to help increase muscle gain. I mean, you can do ice baths, you can do rolling, you can do sports massage, you can do all kinds of things. But the most important thing of all is getting enough sleep. If doing all these other things detracts from your sleep, it's a net negative because sleep is far more important than doing foam rollers or stretching or ice baths. Same goes for calf raises and all these little muscle groups. If you're a pro bodybuilder, you gotta do those because that's what the judges are looking for, is all those little muscles to make sure that they're all proportional. But very few people are going to be judged in a bodybuilding contest. So, you know, who cares if wrists and your pinky muscles are up to the standard of your pecs and your lats? What's more important is overall conditioning. I have no idea what I'm saying here, but that's okay. Bike is a quad workout. If you're biking up steep hills like I used to do, is an amazing quad workout. It, talk about time under tension. It's like doing walking lunges for an hour. When you're standing up on the seat and hammering away on those pedals, that is an amazing quad workout. When is your next live? I do not plan lives. I just do them. I refuse to schedule. That's the beauty of retirement. I don't have to do shit. Let's see. My upper chest is lacking. Should I focus on incline presses or continue with flat? I would do a well-rounded chest workout, working everything as hard as you can. People have different genetics. It's possible that it doesn't matter what you're gonna do. So, you know, if you take away your flat bench time to do incline, you might have a decrease in pec mass. Anyway, that is it for today's video, an hour on the subject of the optimal rest for muscle gain. And the answer is, if you're a bodybuilder, the optimal rest is 0.0. Thanks for watching, How Feeders Aim.